Jesse Edwards Stadium here in Huntington, West Virginia. The record attendance for this in-state rivalry. Although Doc Holliday, the head coach, the new head coach at Marshall, was quick to say, this isn't a rivalry. We've never beat them. It'll be a rivalry when we beat them. Nine times the little brother has stepped up against the mighty Mountaineers. Nine times they've been denied. They started playing them in 1911. Rod, and there's been a lot of talk about Marshall arguing to keep the series alive. The governor even had to get involved.
Yeah, well, and Marshall's got to make his case. And they're trying to make their case tonight as to why they ought to be playing this team and that they are good enough to play them.
You hold on to this and you won't need political pressures. Or could it be that Geno Smith and the Mountaineers can pull this one out of the fire? Trailing by eight. Austin, good block, and Austin has a first down for West Virginia just inside the 25.
What a tremendous job the receivers did out there on the edge blocking on that screen. And Austin, great speed, just took off. He saw the blocks and just split them.
Devine now. Geno Smith tried to run ahead and give him a block, and Devine gets it down to the 20. And that clock becoming a concern. Under a minute to go. One timeout remaining. Number 23 in the country against the upset-minded Marshall squad. Smith. And Austin does the smart thing and gets out of bounds right near that first down marker.
How about the patience Smith has shown on this drive? Hasn't really forced it, has taken everything given to him. Check down, hot receivers, tuck the ball, run for a first down.
In his first year as the starter, that is, too. So it is a first down. 14-yard line. Geno, lots of time. That ball was inside the five, and the flag comes in. Jock Sanders was going low for that ball, and Omar Brown may have gotten there early, Rod.
Yeah, Brown's been a bit aggressive all night, got flagged earlier for an unsportsmanlike conduct.
Pass interference. 31 on defense. First down, spot of the foul.
34 seconds remain, and it'll be first and goal.
Yeah, Tess, he can't make a play on this ball either. His ball's too low and in the ground. He gets there early.
Will Stewart still needs one final push.
They'll give it to Devine down here. They really trust him with the football down here.
Marshall trying to call a timeout. Devine scores the touchdown, but did they get the timeout? Doc Holliday was running onto the field. Doc Holliday was sprinting as if he was in the NFL combine trying to prove himself all the way down to the 10-yard line, and he got the timeout.
And they didn't have enough guys on the field. He was trying to run a guy on the field, and he was short a guy, and he was going to get flagged for the guy running out on the field late anyway. Take a look at the bottom of the screen. You'll see a guy come running on for Marshall. Right there, bottom of the screen. They were short. That's Jackson. No, it's not Jackson. Who's that?
Ahmad Shakur.
Shakur's running on.
And then there's Doc Holliday.
Yep.
Down there at the 10-yard line.
Yeah, they would have been flagged for that late substitution. Plus, it was offsides also running on the field.
So getting that timeout in just before the snap, that took away what West Virginia assumed was going to be the touchdown by Devine. This is the 14th play of a drive that started at their own 2-yard line, first and goal.
This is really Devine's territory. They love to give him the ball down here, not just because of his speed, but they trust him with the football.
Smith Smith is taken down at the five. Vinny Curry again. They have a timeout left. They're going to hurry up and get off a play here. Smith to pass. Still looking. Wide open in the back of the end zone. Touchdown, Will Johnson. 12 seconds left, and West Virginia is a two-point conversion away from tying this game.
How about Smith's composure and patience? He waits a long time and throws a perfect ball in the deep corner. Are you kidding me? Look at that. That's a great catch. And then 1-2. Only needs 1 foot in. Gets the left one in.
Keep in mind, this is a drive that started at their own 2-yard line. They're taking a look at this catch by Will Johnson, but I think we showed a pretty good look at it, Rob.
Yeah, it's not an issue of whether he had control of the ball. It is simply that left foot wasn't in bounds. And from our first view, it looked like he got that left foot down without it being on the in line of the end zone. Watch the left foot. Catch, toe, that looks like it's in. See a little green behind him. And you need indisputable video evidence to overturn the touchdown call on the field. That's a tremendous catch. Leaping high and getting that foot down.
The clock was running. They didn't use their timeout. Smith lined them up and said, let's play ball and try to make this happen.
How about the great coaching decisions by Stewart in the fourth quarter? Going for the 1 point to get themselves within the two possession, giving his quarterback time, making sure that they didn't try and get too much. They took their time getting down the field, using Noel Devine, and getting themselves right back in position.
West Virginia was trailing in the fourth quarter 21-6. Their two scoring drives went 96 yards and 98 yards. But it's all going to come down to 3 yards.
Yep. 2 points.
Assuming this review holds up, which it should. And Marshall was in position when the score was 21-6 to put this game away, and they gave the ball to the freshman running back who fumbled at the four.
Yeah. Tron Martinez, struggling for a little extra yardage, had George Wright jump on him from behind.
After review, Green on the field stands. Touchdown, West Virginia.
All right, Rod, what do you dial up here to tie this game?
Well, the first assumption from everybody, I would believe, is Noel Devine, is getting him the football. I think Marshall's going to be looking that way. So you may have to look more, just like they did, corner the end zone, some sort of a run-pass option for Smith. But Devine is going to get lots of attention right now.
Will this define a program for Marshall, or will number 23 send it to overtime? Considering that Marshall could have sealed this game.
You see, everyone trying to keep defenders in front of them. Sanders works the back of the end zone. Smith understands it. Nice touch on it.
Just a nod of the head from Bill Stewart. Meanwhile, for Doc Holliday, that stings. Two scoring drives
of 96 yards, 98 yards in the fourth quarter, plus the two-point conversion.
Hey, Tess, this is what we're talking about. A lot of teams play zone down in the end zone here, and they really set up a picket line. Look at all the green shirts lined up on the goal line. So if you want to work and score in here, you got to work the back of the end zone. And that's exactly what they do here. Get behind those guys and work the back of the end zone.
There was 8.5 minutes on the clock, 21-6, and Marshall fumbled at the 4. Evans now. Troy Evans gets out across the 40 with 4 seconds left. Well, did you see the East Carolina game the other day?
Yeah, we've had our share of overtime games. Hail Mary touches already this season.
Worth a shot.
Well, you figure you might get it. You might get a penalty. Anything that will give you one more play or one more shot.
Wilson, Dobson for the top side for Anderson. Hook and lateral. Loose ball, scooped up, clock runs out. Andre Booker secured the ball, and we've got overtime between West Virginia and Marshall. A great comeback by the Mountaineers. Overtime when we return.
This is Dr. Pepper Cherry. It's got a little kiss of cherry flavor.
You want cherry? How about a little kiss?
You can't beat a little kiss of cherry. Trust me, I'm a doctor.
Day one storm, and it was beautiful. So look, see the sights that you like.
AT&T covers 97% of all Americans. AT&T, rethink possible. Buy a Pantech messaging phone like the Impact and get a Pantech messaging phone free after mail-in rebate.
Chris Davis with you in the studio. We'll take you to Houston and UTEP as soon as we're finished at Marshall. Trevor Vitito of UTEP finding Pierce Hunter. It's 7-0. Remember, Joe, 99 points scored last year in these two men. Houston's on the move now.
So UTEP off to a start here, and we've got a fabulous finish here. Joe Tessitore and Rob Gilmore with you in Huntington, West Virginia for overtime. Defense first, as is the case. Rod, let it be known, if this does come down to the kicker, West Virginia's got the edge in that department. I'll say one other thing. We haven't seen the Marshall offense in a long time here.
Yeah, they're probably a little frustrated, a little cold. You know, they're not in a rhythm right now. But, you know, this is a whole new deal. You got 25 yards, like baseball, home team, visiting team. You get another at bat if you're on defense versus, which is what we have here with West Virginia. So we'll see how this goes forward. But you have to feel like West Virginia is in a flow right now, a rhythm with the way Smith has been handling the football at quarterback.
We'll see. Let's show you the rules for overtime here. Of course, as Rod says, it is baseball style. You match. Each team gets a possession, 25-yard line, you start, no game clock, no play clock. If we get to a third overtime and the way this game has gone, that could be the case. You must go for two after scoring a touchdown. But as I said, if the kickers are getting involved, we know what we're getting with Victor and West Virginia. He is solid. We also know that Uncle Mo momentum is on the side of that Mountaineer offense. Two scoring drives in the fourth quarter to mount this comeback. 96-yarder and a 98-yarder.
I am still troubled by that drive when Marshall was up by two scores and they backed off of the pressure and they played their safeties 20 yards deep.
Let him come right down the field.
West Virginia took advantage of it, threw the ball in the middle, got a score to get within one possession, and then had that last drive, last score right before regulation ended.
So West Virginia on offense to start our first overtime. Smith to pass. Loses the ball. Jumps right on it. Well, that was critical.
Wow.
James Rouse was right there with Geno Smith, and if Rouse had gotten to that ball, Marshall would have been set just to simply score a field goal and win this game.
Well, if Geno Smith doesn't lose his ball, he's got his man Devine sitting right out there. He's going to go a long way.
So West Virginia is now backed up to the 34. Now they get Devine, blockers in front. And he is still on his feet, down to the original line of scrimmage, the 25. Tackled by Kevin Perry. Marshall has had leads against West Virginia before, but this one was awful late with a chance to put it away. West Virginia has never lost to Marshall. Third and 10. Austin. First down, still on his feet, run out at the 12.
Tess, we talked about yards after the catch.
Well, and Tavon Austin's the man for that.
Oh, when he's in space, a little bit of room, he makes guys miss. He gets plenty of yardage after the catch. It's like a long handoff to him.
So a first down at the 12. Devine the lone back as Smith is now under center. Sanders in motion. Pitch to Devine. Cuts back inside the 10, driving his feet forward to the 5.
He is dynamic. That should have been a 3 or 4 yard loss. But he sticks that foot in the ground, and he changes direction right now.
Rod, how tired is this Marshall defense after giving up those two long drives in the fourth quarter?
Oh, well, they have to be really burned, really burned.
Devine has 110 yards. Ryan Clark, now in that fullback position in front of Devine. Here is Noel. Short of that first down line. Kellen Harris and Donald Brown on the tackle. Marshall saying, hey, we came up with that football. But it'll end up as a third and short here.
He may only be 5'8", but he's very strong. Devine really can go inside. How about, that's Clark. Just taking Brown and throwing him to the ground, and no official saw it or flagged it.
He just peeled him off. Third and 2. Clark now the big back. Smith being chased down. Incomplete. So on third and short, Vinnie Curry chasing down Geno Smith again.
Well, I'm surprised that they went with that with the package they had in.
They had the jumbo backfield in that they've had success with, and yet they do that.
Yeah. And Marshall, kudos to Vinnie Curry for holding down his edge and making sure he didn't let the quarterback, Smith, get outside of him.
Tyler Bittencourt, remember he had one block. Had that clutch game-winning field goal against Pitt. This attempt just from 20. And he puts it through with ease. So let's show you how we arrived at overtime. They were down 21-6, and then they got the ball back. One last desperation starting from their own 2-yard line.
Yeah, and Noel Devine was huge on that drive, as was Smith, making great decisions. When he tucked the ball and ran, it was the right thing to do. Short passes, many of them going, and Noel Devine got them going before they got the touchdown pass in the corner of the end zone. And that was a nice, quick catch. Will Johnson kept that left foot down. A great catch.
West Virginia's first lead of the game now comes in overtime. Geno Smith trying to define himself early on in his West Virginia career. Remember, UTEP, Houston still to come your way. Booker taken down. A big loss on the play. Najee Good getting after Booker. Reminder, when we are done, we will get you out to see UTEP and Case Keenum and Houston. We're now a 2nd and 17.
Wilson has been the big go-to guy on the outside.
He is number 9. He's been a star tonight for the Herd. Anderson now has time, and he's able to get it to Dobson. Dobson cut down at the 22. Reminder that UTEP Houston can be seen on ESPN Classic right now, and then we will join it after our conclusion here in Huntington. West Virginia striking first in the first overtime with a field goal from Bittencourt, and now Marshall facing a 3rd and 7.
They need to make sure that they get rid of the ball quickly. Can't take a sack here. You're already in field goal range.
Pressure up the middle. Gets it off. And that falls incomplete. So now they will need the field goal to tie this game.
That was Brenton Browser with the big hit at the end there.
Tyler Warner, the junior from Parkersburg, West Virginia.
He's looking at about a 40-yarder here. 39, 40 yards.
Last week, he was 0 for 1. Doesn't have a lot of experience. 40-yard attempt. His career long is only 37. This to stay alive, or West Virginia wins it. Just missed to the right, and once again, West Virginia has done it against Marshall. A classic comeback. Halfway through the fourth quarter, everything appeared to be lining up, but in the end, this didn't line up.
He pushed it just to the right. It's high enough. It looked like it was almost there, just off to the right.
Tyler Warner. He can't believe it. He thought it possibly just went right over the bar, but not the case. They've been playing this series since 1911. Doc Holliday was on that West Virginia staff. And now he came so close but could not pull it out. Two big drives in the fourth quarter. A 96-yard drive, a 98-yard drive, the two-point conversion, and then the field goal in overtime. The great comeback by West Virginia. Number 23 avoids the upset, 24-21 in overtime. We're going to get you out to UTEP and Houston. For Rod Gilmore and our entire crew, I'm Joe Tessitore. Glad you were with us tonight. Coming up next, UTEP and Houston. More college football on your Friday. Enjoy.
And I would like to welcome those of you that have been watching West Virginia defeat Marshall 24-21 in overtime. And we'll get you caught up on the action here in Houston shortly with Case Keenum and the Cougars ready to go. These are two high-powered offenses. Both were in the top 20 in the country last year. And Houston was number one in scoring at 42 points per game. Look at that entire possession so far.
They don't waste a lot of time.
Cougars don't care.
They get the ball and they're trying to get down the field like fast break basketball on grass.
Their first team offense was on the field for only about 7.5 minutes last week, and they still put up 48 points. Let's get you caught up on the scoring. UTEP on its first drive. Trevor Vidito out to Chris Adams, who does the tightrope walk down the sideline. And that helps set up Vidito to Pierce Hunter for the touchdown from 7 yards out. Patrick Edwards makes the catch for the short gain for Houston. And let's get you caught up on the Cougars on their first drive. Case Keenum, 8th in the Heisman Trophy voting last year. Looking deep, 61 yards to Patrick Edwards. He stumbled at the 4. And then Michael Hayes took it from there to tie it at 7 apiece. The give is to Bryce Beal. He's got room up the middle across the 45 into UTEP territory. Breaking tackles all the way down to the 37. 35 yards on the pickup for Beal. Jamon Reed made the tackle.
And it's a great read by Case Keenum, because this offense is in his control. He sees that there's not very many guys in the box for UTEP. There's only 7 guys there, so he runs the ball, that inside dive, for a big game.
Keenum to the air. Edwards in the end zone. Penalty flag, as Edwards, was he able to hang on in the back of the end zone? He was. Touchdown, Cougars.
Interference. Number 2 defense. The play on the field has been ruled an incomplete pass. 15 yards. Line of scrimmage. Automatic first down.
But Houston has come out, and they are throwing the ball down the field, and that's unlike what they do in this offense. They've come out and consciously thrown the ball down the field. You can see how far down the field the ball is thrown. They get the interference on DeSean Grayson. Watch at the end of the play. Grayson just loses the ball. Doesn't do a great job of tracking it here. Just interferes with Edwards, who actually catches the ball, but looks like he came down out of bounds.
So they will get the interference penalty on Grayson.
When he had possession, he was out of bounds.
And there's the clarification.
And there's the interference. Great job catching the ball, and I didn't see much of a bobble there, and maintained possession all the way through the ground. You see clearly in bounds right there, and has possession of the ball, and doesn't look like that ball moved at all to me.
RG Dettillier, the referee, over with the headset on now to talk to the replay booth.
Oh, there's the bobble. Just a little bobble right there. See at the end. Watch at the end. The ball does bobble. He's out of bounds, and you've got to maintain possession of that ball all the way through. Right there at the end, but it's a tough call. It's tough to overturn that after making the call on the field. I don't think that there's going to be just inconclusive evidence to overturn that call. It was that close.
This is a UTEP team that is one of the most experienced in the country, with 26 seniors, but JC, most of those guys are on offense.
Incomplete pass. The 15-yard interference penalty will be enforced from the previous spot. 15 yards, automatic first down.
And they are really attacking this young defense early with the deep ball.
They are, and UTEP's defensive game plan was to play all zone and try to keep everything in front of them, but their defensive backs don't have the speed, even in zone coverage, to cover these Houston wide receivers, because that typically is not what the Cougars like to do, throw it down the field. But obviously they feel like they've got an advantage. They found something, and Keenum's just throwing the ball way down the field for completion.
Set up on the 22-yard line, first and 10. Hand up. Michael Hayes trying to find some space up the middle. Thrown back out of the pack. Jamard Reed picking up the helmet.
You know, Beth, UTEP has a new defensive coordinator and a new scheme this year also. Andre Patterson comes in, and he went from a 3-3-5 that they ran last year to now a 4-3 to get a bigger body on the field. Now you got to play zone, and you see the safeties hanging back. That's normally when Houston will run the ball because there's not enough guys inside to stop the run.
Did again up the middle inside the 15-yard line. Michael Hayes, pickup of 7 on the play.
But again, as I was talking about, with 7 guys in the box, there are guys short. They don't really have enough guys to stop Brad Beal in this rushing attack, and that's all on Case Keenum. When he sees that, he's going to try to attack with the run.
Hayes again. Nice juke move to get to the outside. Stays on his feet with a couple of defenders hanging on him. 7-yard line and another first down. Jamie Irving with the tackle.
That's just a scouting report thing. They got to know that when Hayes is in the game, he likes to bounce things to the outside because he's not a very big guy. But you can see, good job keeping those legs moving.
Powers it inside the 5. Bryce Beal with the carry. Going to work behind that offensive line, which includes first-year starting center Jordan Shoemaker, as well as Isaiah Thompson, their left guard, who is a converted nose tackle. That's who they follow again. And across the goal line, Bryce Beal, touchdown from 5 yards out.
UTEP went to that 4-3 defense to get more physical at the line of scrimmage, but they're just getting beaten physically right now. Great job by Roy Watts, number 74, and Chris Thompson just pushing down the defensive line.
Hogan's PAT. 2 possessions, 2 touchdowns for the nation's top scoring team from a year ago.
Introducing the new Big Italy Pizza from Pizza Hut. Bigger than 2 medium pizzas, it's 18 slices of hand-stretched crust with up to 3 of your favorite toppings, all for just $12. And for a limited time, get a free 2-liter Pepsi Max when you buy any 2-liter Pepsi, only at your Pizza Hut.
Every day, it's getting closer, going faster than a roller coaster. Love like yours will surely come my way.
AT&T and BlackBerry teamed up to evolve the smartphone. Business, meet fun. Fun, business. AT&T, rethink possible.
Taken Accutane, you may have a claim. After investigation by the FDA, Accutane was taken off the market by the manufacturer in 2009. Studies show Accutane may cause Crohn's disease, colitis, and inflammatory bowel disease. If you took Accutane and suffer from Crohn's disease, colitis, or IBD, call 1-800-BAD-DRUG. Time is running out to file your claim. For a free confidential consultation, call 1-800-BAD-DRUG now.
Absolutely. This policy is customized just for you.
This will save you the most money while making sure that you have the auto coverage that you need.
This is good stuff.
Yeah, no problem. I'm a coverage counselor. It's what I do. Well, thank you for being an Esurance customer. Great. Bye, Richard. So did you guys get enough to make an online version of a coverage counselor?
Yep. It's code it and load it.
Oh. You're so popular. Like prom queen.
Want a great deal on car insurance? Go to Esurance.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Bud Light. It's the sure sign of a good time. Here we go. And Denny's 2468 value menu. Try 16 different value meals all day, every day.
Back here in Houston in Robertson Stadium, And the Houston Cougars leading UTEP 14-7, 3:14 to go in the first quarter. A couple of possessions for Houston and a couple of scores. Case Keenum, the senior from Abilene, the Conference USA Offensive Player of the Year and MVP last season, guiding them successfully down the field. Jordan Menisto to kick it off. And over the head of McClure and out. UTEP will start on the 20-yard line. And JC, let's check out the Miners' impact players.
Well, without Donald Buckram playing, their star running back, Trevor Vidato, the quarterback, he really has to step up. He's done a good job so far in this game, but he's got to manage this game, make some plays with his arm. And when he does that, Chris Adams is the guy that he has to look for. 16 career touchdowns. He's the main guy in the passing game for UTEP. And defensively, Braxton Amy's got to show up. We haven't talked about him yet tonight. He's got to make some plays. They feel like he's a big-time player for them.
Vidato, 6-for-8 so far tonight, 62 yards, and he's got the touchdown pass to Pierce Hunter. Vidato chased out of the pocket, and he'll throw it away. Houston's new defensive alignment for new coordinator Brian Stewart. It's a 3-4 alignment led by Matangi Tonga, their nose tackle, the senior from San Mateo, California. The linebackers, Marcus McGraw, averaged 11 tackles a game last year. That was fifth most in the country. And the defensive coordinator Stewart calls Nick Sines the QB of the DBs. He's the one that runs the show for them deep. Vidato, short drop, connects with Russell Carr, close to the first down marker at the 30-yard line. Marcus McGraw with the tackle. The big news tonight for UTEP, Donald Buckram, who did not play in the season opener with a bruised left knee, tried to go tonight, but so far unsuccessful in his attempts to get ready to get out on the field.
Yeah, pregame, he tried to come out and see if he can get that knee loose, but just too stiff for him. He's got that bone bruise, and that's a big loss for them tonight, not having Buckram.
Fourth best rusher in the country last year. And on first down, a pickup of a couple. Leland Myers, the junior out of Compton, California. So without Buckram, they're going to run Myers, Banyard, and Frazier. Try three guys by committee.
Yeah, running back by committee, but they've got to find a way to manufacture a running game because they've got to continue to make first downs, run time off of this clock, and try to keep that offense of Houston on the sidelines. And you can't just do that through the air. You've got to try to establish a running game.
Banyard and Frazier did combine last week in Buckram's absence for over 180 yards rushing. Looking for Frazier out of the backfield. Across the 45. Hauled down at the 48-yard line.
Vernon Frazier is a small guy, 5'7", 170. Does a good job of just leaking out of the backfield. Steps up like he's going to pass protect, but he's actually releasing, just runs a check down route, and they get the ball to him quickly for a first down.
26 yards on the pickup. Frazier, the junior out of Duncanville, Texas. That'll move the chains again. Four receivers for UTEP. Vidato, he's got a lot of room. Flags fly as he takes it inside the 40-yard line. Stepping out of bounds at the 36.
Holding. 65. Offense. 10-yard penalty on the line of scrimmage. Replay first down.
That's Anthony McNack, one of their best offensive linemen. You're going to see on the right side, number 65 right there, just gets his hands outside the shoulders of the defender and is holding that jersey. Anytime you get your hands outside the shoulders and they see some jersey pull, they're going to call you for holding.
He hauled down Tyrone Campbell. That offensive line, the anchor of this offense, five seniors starting for them, and they've got to be the ones to open up the holes for their ground game. Mike Price calls it the strength of this team. Corey Crispy taken down at the 44-yard line. Pickup of six. Nick Sines on the stop. UTEP scored on its first possession to take the 7-0 lead. Houston has countered quickly. Two touchdowns in 13 plays. Last year, as the nation's best offense, they scored points on the average once every 13 plays. Two of them tonight
for
Houston.
It doesn't take them long, that's for sure. That's why UTEP wanted to try to keep the ball in front, but they haven't been able to do it.
A whistle before the snap.
Full start. 54. Offense. 5-yard penalty.
And the group that is supposed to be the strength for UTEP has been the weakness on this possession.
Well, that's some of the problems that a 3-4 gives you as an offensive lineman. There are so many guys that can come in so many different combinations. You know the three down linemen, but then you've got to identify the linebackers, and you don't know which guy's coming. Creates a lot of confusion.
First quarter comes to a close tonight at Robertson Stadium. The Houston Cougars behind All-America.